I'm Cindy Booth. I'm director at Child Advocates. We're the CASA program in Marion County. We represent abused and neglected children by using community volunteers, training them, recruiting them. We have social workers. We have a nice team that works on behalf of the children in Marion County.
Life without Child Advocates would be a very confusing place for children. They're important in recognizing the child is a person with needs, and they're there for the child. So often adults get involved and things get very confusing, and Child Advocates makes a place for the child and gives a comfort to the child, instruction, education, experiences that they may not have without Child Advocates.
Well, Child Advocates provides a great program because they are actually the voice of the child. And when I hear from my guardian ad litem in court, I know that they are truly speaking for the child. I know that they are representing what their investigation and what their recommendations and, most importantly, what the child wants.
In a really good space, every child would have a child advocate, that court-appointed special advocate. That's not the case. We have huge waiting list at this point. I've taken it as my goal that we want to have more volunteers from the community seeing more children more often.
My name's Annie, and I like to play volleyball, and I go to the school NIS, and I like to eat a lot of leftovers.
She was in an inpatient institution and came to us as a foster daughter, and she was absolutely lovely.
Child Advocates helped me by telling me what problems I had so I would understand a little bit more. And they would tell me, like, I might be in a different family, so I would be up for the thing that was coming. And they had some visits from my first adoption parents, because I was in two other foster homes before I came here.
She had quite a bit of difficulty expressing herself emotionally, but she's come a long way since she's come to us initially.
You know, Annie is a great kid. She's a prime example of why you don't put limitations on children. She is placed in the right environment and has exceeded all expectations as a result.
This is my family.
A situation in which I had a reunification case was about 4 or 5 years ago. A 5-year-old African-American little boy named Kylan, rambunctious little boy that had been recently diagnosed with ADHD. And his mother had a difficult time disciplining him and really trying to respond to his behavior. And he was a very spirited young man. And so one of the family members had called in for help, and Kylan was removed. And over the course of about 4 or 5 months, we went into the home, worked with the mother, and got her services, got her parenting classes, and Kylan was returned back to his mom in just literally 4 months. And so myself and the home-based counselor stayed on for about 3 or 4 months past that to make sure that Kylan was back home and safe and sound and back in school. And I remember the last day when we went in, we were going to close the case, and I spoke with his mom and said, you know, how are you really feeling? How are things going with Kylan? And she kind of sat down and she sighed and she said, well, honestly, it's tough. It's still tough, but I can say that things are better. And that's when Kylan ran in and gave me a hug and ran out to go get himself some chocolate milk. and that's when that was the last day of the case, and that's when we kind of wrapped things up. But I will never forget the image of Kylan running in, smiling, giving me that hug, and then running out to go get his chocolate milk.
My mom had me when she was 14. She was doing a lot of drugs, so she wasn't able to take care of me. My mom left me And my brother and my little brother, he was a baby by then. She left us at the doorstep of my youngest brother's daddy's house. Throughout my whole foster care career, I stayed in 21 different homes. So, I mean, that's a lot of homes. I moved from respite care to foster care to guardian home to group homes to facilities, locked up facilities. It was tough for me. I couldn't really understand why nobody wanted to adopt me. My life would be pretty different if a child advocate hadn't played a big role in it. And they cared for me at the time when nobody else did. So I believe I'd probably be doing some crazy things, not caring, not knowing. They had more faith in me when I didn't have faith in myself. My high school counselor asked me, what do I want to do after high school? And I looked at her and I was like, well, I want to go to college. And she looked at me and it was kind of like a laugh. And so she was like, with these grades, there's not too many places you can go. And I said, I want to go to Indiana University. She's like, well, maybe you want to just get your GED. I'm a senior here at Indiana University.
A person who gave funding to Child Advocates could help a child have a voice in court for every hearing for a year for $500 for the whole year.
One of the frustrating things that I encounter almost on a daily basis is that Child Advocates is not funded to the extent that they should be.
Regular people who are concerned about children dying from abuse and neglect or suffering abuse and neglect can get involved, because in Indiana, we believe that every child should be represented by a CASA. And until that happens, we have lots of work to do.